Hey, while you're in the first 5 seconds of the video, go ahead, like and subscribe.
Shalom, Israel. This is Bishop Nathaniel. I want you to know that you can view all our Sabbath classes live on IUIC TV. That's right. I said on IUIC TV. Download the app today. Shalom.
All right. So let's get started. I'm going to just jump right into it. Lost a bit of time. So like I said, it's the title of the class is Self-Examination is the Catalyst for Change. So we're going to start out with 2 Corinthians chapter 13 and verse 5. It says, examine yourselves, whether ye be in the faith. Prove your own selves. Know ye not your own selves, how that Jesus Christ is in you, except ye be reprobates? So we see here the scriptures tell us to examine ourselves. A lot of times what I like to do, I like to look up the words that are in the Bible because it gives us a clearer understanding of what these words mean and what we should be doing as we working towards applying these commandments. So the definition of examine is inspect someone or something in detail to determine their nature or condition. Investigate thoroughly. Some of the key synonyms that it had was study, survey, and analyze. So when the Bible says examine yourselves, we have to study ourselves. We have to analyze ourselves, survey. We have to ask questions. Okay, why did I do this? Or how did I do that? How did I interact with my brothers or my sister today? How did I interact with my children? How did I interact with my wife? How did I do this? That's examining yourselves. And when you examine yourselves, whatever the answer is, you have to compare it to the Bible. That's you inspecting your life. Because when you look at the definition of inspect, it says to look at closely, typically to assess condition, to discover any shortcomings. So when we examine ourselves, we're looking for what are my shortcomings? Do I have a lustful spirit? Am I covetous? Do I have evil? Am I evil surmising towards my brothers and sisters? We have to examine those things because if we're doing those things, then what we have to do is find the scriptures that instruct us to do otherwise so that we can wash our minds from the filth that's in our minds. So that's what we have to do. That's one of the things that we have to do. So from there, we're going to come back to 2 Corinthians chapter 13 and verse 5. But we looking at examine yourselves, whether ye be in the faith, prove your own selves, know ye not your own selves. So we have to know ourselves. We can't be phony. We can't be fake. When we examine ourselves, we got to be fully honest. Excuse me. We got to be fully honest with ourselves for the things that it is what it is. And then we have to find the scriptures to fix those things. If you're a thief, you got to find scriptures on thou shalt not steal. You got Ephesians, not doing those things no more. And you got to meditate on it continually. So we're going to move over to 1 Corinthians chapter 11 and verse 31. 1 Corinthians chapter 11 and verse 31. So it says, for if we would judge ourselves, we should not be judged. If we would judge ourselves, meaning going right back to what it said in 2 Corinthians 13. If we would judge ourselves, meaning if we would examine ourselves. Then I'm going to read the definition of judge. It says, to form an opinion about through careful weighing of evidence and testing of premises. To determine or pronounce after inquiry and deliberation. So imagine if you ever been in a courtroom for a ticket, whatever the case may be. When you go into that courtroom, that judge is going to examine you. The judge is going to ask you questions to try to gauge your character gauge how you are. That's what we got to do to ourselves. We got to ask ourselves questions. It's almost like journaling. You're creating a journal of yourself. Okay, on December 31st, 2023, what are the things that I do? What are the things that I did? And did they line up with the Bible? Was I covetous? Did I have any covetous thoughts? And did I act on those covetous thoughts? Did I have any thoughts of evil towards my brother? And did I correct those thoughts with the scriptures? We have to constantly examine the thoughts that we think and the actions that we take off those thoughts. Because a lot of times the thoughts are going to come. But we have to make sure that we're meditating in the scriptures to ensure that when those thoughts come, we're able to combat them thoughts with the word of God. And that's what it means when it says examine yourselves. When we examine ourselves, we survey ourselves to see if we actually in this faith, if we actually in the truth, or we are, or if we are phonies. So going along, we're going to go to Psalms chapter 119 and verse 59. And I apologize if I'm moving a little fast. I also apologize for my voice overcoming a little bit of hoarseness. It was a lot worse, but it's getting better. But Psalms 119, I'm going to actually start at verse 57. It says, "Thou art my portion, O Lord. I have said that I would keep thy words." So all of us here, we here, we watching the classes day in and day out. We here. So this is us. We said, "I have said that I will keep thy words." We all said it. If you broke bread, you said, "I'm going to keep the commandments. I'm going to do what God told me to do. I found out I'm an Israelite. The Most High showed me mercy. I'm here, so I'm keeping these commandments." So let's see. Let's read on. "I entreated thy favor with my whole heart." We know that the heart is referring to our minds. It says, "Be merciful unto me according to thy word." So we all ask for mercy because our ways are perverse before him. But our job is to continually work and act towards keeping the commandments. Verse 59. "I thought on my ways and turned my feet unto thy testimonies." So that's us examining ourselves. Right back to 2 Corinthians 13. "I thought on my ways." So I thought on the things that I was doing. And it says, "and turned my feet unto thy testimony." So anything that's in our lives that don't line up with the Bible, we got to correct it. We got to do that work to actually correct it. As we all been watching, we've been watching what the leadership been bringing out about destruction, about how we're going to be persecuted, things like that. We strengthen our faith to be able to go through those persecutions and endure by getting our mind right. Because as we apply that discipline to fix the things that's going on in our lives, we fixing, okay, if you was a thief, if you was a murderer, whatever background you have, whatever things you were engulfed in, as you fix those things, you're applying discipline. And that discipline is building up your faith. That discipline is building up your faith. So when the times of persecution come, because you've worked over the course of the time that you've been in this truth, you worked that discipline to change your ways, you're not going to fold because you've actually applied yourself. You fasted. You prayed. You restrained yourself from your lust. You did the necessary things to get yourself right. So now when that time come, you've proved that this word is right. Like it says in Romans chapter 12 and 1, you've proved what is the good word of God because you've applied it. So now when that time of persecution come, you ain't scared to go through that persecution. You ain't scared of that persecution because you've applied yourself and you know that this Bible is real. You know that the things that's written is for us, and if we endure, we're going to get the thing. We're going to get the things that the Most High told us we're going to get. Go to Sirach real quick. Go to Sirach chapter 5 and verse 2. It says, "Follow not thine own mind." Read that again. "Follow not thine own mind and strength to walk in the ways of thy heart." So this is what we have to do. When we examine ourselves, we're examining ourselves to not follow after our own thoughts, our own mind. we it says to walk in the ways of our heart. Because of the ways of our heart, real quick, the ways of our heart. Let's see what the ways of our heart is. Mark chapter 7 and verse 21. So it says, for from within, out of the heart of men, proceed evil thoughts, adulteries, fornications, murders, thefts, covetousness, wickedness, deceit, lasciviousness, an evil eye, blasphemy, pride, foolishness. All these evil things come from within and defile the man. These are the things that's in our mind. So if we're not examining ourselves, we're letting these things run rampant in our lives. But when we examine ourselves and we find the scriptures, we find the medicine to fix those things, we on the right path, because now we're applying discipline to correct our ways, to correct our wicked thoughts, to correct our wicked actions. And then it says, I thought on my ways and turned my feet. Let's go to Deuteronomy chapter 8 and verse 5 real quick. Forgive me if I'm bouncing kind of fast, just trying to make sure, trying to play catch up, but lost about 30 minutes. Deuteronomy chapter 8 and verse 5. It says, thou shalt also consider in thine heart that as a man chasteneth his son, so the Lord thy God chasteneth thee. As we've seen, we in this captivity, we going through hell here. We being chastened of the Lord because of our sins, because of the ways that our ways was first before him. So now we're being chastened. Verse 6, therefore, thou shalt keep the commandments of the Lord thy God to walk in his ways and to fear him. So when David said in Psalms 119, I turn my feet unto thy testimonies, it's right here, to walk in his ways, to turn our feet into his testimonies, is to walk in his ways, which is his commandments. Thou shalt not steal. Thou shalt not commit adultery. Honor thy father and mother. Keep the Sabbath. Remember to keep the Sabbath day holy. All of those things are us returning our feet unto the commandments of God. So I'm going to jump over to Isaiah chapter 8 and verse 16. It says, as David said, we're going to turn our feet unto his testimonies. Isaiah chapter 8 and verse 16 says, bind up the testimony, seal the law among my disciples. So that testimony is the laws of God. So when David said he turned his feet unto thy testimonies, it means he turned his feet unto God's laws. He walked in God's ways. He kept the commandments. So that's when, as we're examining ourselves, we have to make sure that our ways and the actions that we do on a day-to-day basis, that is lining up with the Most High God. And we got to do this daily. Like Paul said, I die daily. It's not a once-a-week thing, a twice-a-week thing. No, daily we got to examine ourselves. We got to go into the scriptures and find the scriptures with the things that we battle with and continually meditate on them, because that's how we're going to direct our ways according to the commandments. So I'm going to read Psalms 119 and verse 59 again. It says, I thought on my ways and turned my feet unto thy testimonies. Verse 60, it says, I made haste and delayed not to keep thy commandments. So as we examine our ways, we got to make sure we making quick moves to correct our ways, because we don't know. This is why we got to make quick moves. Real quick, it's Job. Job chapter 14 and verse 5. Because we got to see the importance of that. Why did David say, I made haste? He said, I made haste and delayed not to keep thy commandments. Why did he make haste? Job chapter 14 and verse 5. It says, seeing his days are determined, the number of his months are with thee. Thou hast appointed his bounds that he cannot pass. All of us have a time limit on this earth. None of us know when it's our time to go. So that's why it's of utmost importance that we make haste to change our ways. It's not easy to our flesh, but we got to make haste and we got to apply discipline to change our ways, because we don't know if we're going to be here tomorrow. We don't know if we walk out of our house today and on our way to work, we get in a terrible accident. Something bad happens where we may lose our life. We don't know that. So that's why David says he made haste and delayed not to keep the commandments. So that's the mindset that we have to incorporate in our lives, that every day we making those moves to correcting our ways and returning back to the Most High God. From there, go to Proverbs chapter 23 and verse 7. Proverbs 23 and verse 7. Because to change your actions, you got to actually change the way you think. You got to change your mind. You got to consume yourself in the Bible, so that your ways will line up, so your thoughts are washed, so to say, with the word of God, like it say in Ephesians chapter 5 and 26. But Proverbs chapter 23 and verse 7. For as he thinketh in his heart, so is he. Eat and drink, saith he to thee, but his heart is not with thee. So we want that first part. It says, for as he thinketh in his heart, so is he. So how you think, that's how you are. That's how you're going to be. That's how you're going to act. Whatever you think in your mind, those your actions are going to follow that. So we got to make sure that we are reading our four chapters a day. And outside of the reading the four chapters a day, you got to be examining yourself. You have to be studying those scriptures that pertain to the lust. You got to study the whole Bible. Don't get me wrong. But you have to study sin specific. You got to focus in on the things that you battle with, so that you can focus in on those things and you can deaden that spirit within you, that mind thought, that mind process in you, and turn it to the scriptures, turn it to God's laws. So from there, we're going to go to Proverbs chapter 4. Proverbs chapter 4 and verse 20. So Proverbs chapter 4, on your own time, read the whole chapter, because the whole chapter is going into this of us focusing ourselves on keeping the commandments, focusing on waking up night and day and turning to the commandments. So we're going to read verse 20 through 27. So Proverbs chapter 4 and verse 20 says, my son, attend to my words, incline thine ear unto my sayings. Let them not depart from thine eyes. Keep them in the midst of thine heart. So in order to do that, we got to be meditating on the scriptures. Go to Joshua chapter 1 and verse 8. Joshua chapter 1, verse 8 says, this book of the law shall not depart out of thy mouth, but thou shalt meditate therein day and night, that thou mayest observe to do according to all that is written therein. For then thou shalt make thy way prosperous, and then thou shalt have good success. So only when we meditate day and night are we going to have good success at applying the commandments. That's how we mend our ways. That's how we mend ourselves to God. We mend ourselves back to the Most High by correcting our ways. We meditate day and night, and we observing to do. Of course, us that we go out to camp, we teach a lot of the prophets go out and teach. We studying to be able to answer. But first and foremost, you got to study that you got to study so that you can apply. You have to study so that you can apply. So that when you do go out there and teach, you're not being a hypocrite. You have to actually apply the things that you're learning, apply the things that you're meditating on. Back to Proverbs chapter 4, I'm going to read verse 22 and 23. It says, for they are life unto those that find them, and health to all their flesh. If you look in the margin, my Bible got a 6 next to that health. It says medicine. So the Bible is medicine to our wicked ways. The Bible has the medicine to cure our wicked ways. So it says, for they are life unto those that find them, and health to all their flesh. Then verse 23 says, keep thy heart with all diligence, for out of it are the issues of life. So, real quick, I'm going to read this article. No, I'm going to go to Matthew chapter 6 real quick. Matthew chapter 6. In verse 22. It's using different words, but it's saying the same thing that we just read in Proverbs. So Matthew chapter 6 and verse 22. The light of the body is the eye. If therefore thine eye be single, thy whole body shall be full of light. But if thine eye be evil, thy whole body shall be full of darkness. If therefore the light that is in thee be darkness, how great is that darkness? So it says, therefore the light that is in thee be darkness, how great is that darkness? That means that you understand that you're an Israelite. You look at the Bible, but you don't even apply it. But back up to verse 22. It says, the light of the body is the eye. If therefore thine eye be single. Let's look up. So I'm going to read the definition of single. I got a few definitions from a couple of different sources. I'm going to read through them. So this is a dictionary that I have. I have here at my house. It says Double Day Dictionary. Single. Upright. Sincere. Honest. And I also looked up the definition of single-hearted. I wrote that down as well. It says sincere and undivided, as in purpose, dedication, feeling, etc. Also single-minded. It says having only one purpose or end in view, free from duplicity, ingenuous, sincere. So we see one word that we see that go through all of those definitions is sincere. Sincere. So I also looked up the definition of sincere. And remember, we're looking up, the scripture said, the light of the body is the eye. If therefore thine eye be single, meaning you sincere. When you're sincere, you're focused. You're focused on one thing. You're not getting consumed up like we just passed these wicked holidays. Your mind is not diverting back to celebrating Christmas. You weren't out in the club last night turning up, talking about some happy new year. You understand that the new year ain't until the spring, until Passover. You wasn't turning up drinking, going out and getting drunk. You wasn't doing those things because your mind, your eye is single. You're sincere. So this definition of sincere, it says free from hypocrisy. Free from hypocrisy, deceit, or calculation. You're not calculating your steps to make it appear that you're right, but you're not. Honest, genuine, a sincere friend, sincere regrets. So these are those same words in Webster's 1828, single. It says pure, simple, incorrupt, unbiased, having clear vision of divine truth. Clear vision of divine truth. You're not tossed to and fro. You're not watching this camp and that camp and this camp over here and that camp over there. You're not in your own thought process because you think that because you studied the Bible and you read the Bible 20 times, now you study and you teaching yourself. No, you have to be taught. You have to follow the Most High brought you here. You have to stick with that. The Most High brought you here to learn. You have to continue learning. You can't get to a point in your mind that, hey, I read the Bible 10 times. Hey, I know this. I got this. I don't need to watch them classes no more. I came up with my own understanding. No, you can never get to that point where you think like that. Like the scripture says in Sirach 10, I believe, where it says, no, not I'm butchering it. It says, I'm not going to go there for sake of time. But it says, pride goes before destruction and a haughty spirit before a fall. That's in Proverbs. But we can never get our minds to be in that point. And the only way we're going to do that is to continually self-examine. Continually self-examine. So go on. So Webster's 1828 dictionary, the definition of the word sincere. Being in reality what it appears to be. Not feigned, not simulated, not assumed or said for the sake of appearance. Real, not hypocritical or pretended. We have to be real in this truth. So when the Bible said that if therefore thine eye be single, thy whole body shall be full of light. When we sincere and we focused, we align in our ways to be the same in the in-house and out the house, then our life is sincere, and the Most High going to give us understanding. He going to increase our understanding because we're being sincere. So this is another dictionary. This is Vine's expository dictionary of single. It says simple, single. It's used in a moral sense in Matthew 6 and 22 and Luke 11, 34. Said of the eye, singleness of purpose keeps us from the snare of having a double treasure and consequently a divided heart. And actually, just what this said right here, I'm gonna read Matthew 6 and 24. Because Matthew 6 and 24 say the same thing that we just read right here in this definition. It says, no man can serve two masters, for either he will hate the one and love the other, or else he will hold to the one and despise the other. You cannot serve God and mammon. Mammon is, in this context, is riches, treasures. But it also goes into, you can't serve God and Satan. You can't say that you're about the commandments, but then you out committing sin. You out being an adulterer. You about being in a whoremonger. You out being in idolatry, which is what we just passed, this falsemas and this fake New Year's. You're not partaking in those things because you're sincere. You have a single mind. You're focused on keeping the commandments and getting your mind right. So I'm going to put up this article real quick that I got about the eye, because the Matthew says, if therefore thine eye be single, thy whole body shall be full of light. So Christ used an allegory comparing how we supposed to be to our physical eye. So I'm going to pull this article up real quick. So the eyes, go down to, what are eyes? So, I'm just going to read the first paragraph. It says, your eyes are the sensory organs that allow you to see. Your eyes capture visible light from the world around you and turn it into a form your brain uses to create your sense of vision. Your brain doesn't have sensory abilities of its own. It needs your eyes and other senses like hearing and touch to gather information about the world about you. So this is translated that we have to make sure that what we're seeing is the commandments. Make sure what's consuming our minds is the commandments. Make sure what's conforming our minds and forming our minds and our actions is the Bible. Because if you consume and you always watching some reality TV show, you always watching some BS, you always listening to worldly music, that's what's forming your mind. It's gonna every time for you read four chapters and then you go watch a reality show. That reality show gonna cancel out everything that you just read. You wake up in the morning, you study on lying, you studied all these scriptures, you meditate on them, but then you go watch a reality TV show. Well, you got a bunch of women, a bunch of men lying and cheating and all up in all type of foolishness. You have just washed away everything that you've looked at in the scriptures because you consumed your mind with foolishness. So we're going to go back to that article. We're going to jump down to the paragraph where it says, how do your eyes work? So how do your eyes work? It says, everything your eyes do starts with light from the outside world. Your eye structure lets light enter and pass through a series of clear components and sections, including the cornea, aqueous humor, lens, virtuous humor, Those structures being in focus light, adjusting how far the light beams travel before they come into focus. So that's how the Bible is. When we remember what it said in Matthew 6 and 23, it says, if therefore the light that is in thee be darkness, how great is that darkness? So what we allow ourselves to see, hear, all of that, it affects our actions. So it says, those structures bend and focus light, adjusting how far the light beams travel before they come into focus. So how much focus we put on applying the commandments, studying the commandments, that's going to shape our lives. It's going to shape our vision of how we're supposed to be. It's going to shape our focus. We know it says the focus needs to be precise. If it isn't, what you're looking at appears blurry. Your eye has muscles that can make subtle changes to the shape of your eye, moving the focus point so it lands correctly on the retina. When light lands on the cells of your retinas, those cells send signals to your brain. The signals are like coded messages describing everything they can about the light. That includes the color, how intense it is, and any other relevant details. Your brain decodes and processes the signals and uses them to build the image you see. So the same function that our physical eyes have towards our brain is the same thing that Christ is pointing out here. So if our focus ain't on the scriptures, our ways and our actions, our focus is going to be off. It's going to be blurry because we're not going to be able to see clearly the things that the Most High is trying to show to us and trying to lead us to, because we're not keeping our mind focused on the commandments. We got our mind focused on the world. We're looking for the, and not saying that we're not going to catch things with when it's on sale and stuff like that, but we got our minds on, man, what's the hottest trend? Let me keep up with the Joneses. Let me keep up with how the world is going. Let me watch that. Man, I got to watch, and I don't watch none of these reality TV shows, so I can't name none of them, but I know they still out there. But a lot of these reality TV shows is out there to deter your mind away from the truth. It makes things blurry. That's why the scriptures, that's why Christ said, the light of the body is the eye. If therefore thine eye be single or focused, like we just read, what the eye does, if your eye is focused, if you're focused on the commandments, you're not tossed to and fro. You're focused on the commandments. It says your whole body shall be full of light, meaning you're going to be full of understanding. And with understanding, you understand what you're doing. You understand why you're walking the way you walk. And that's how we have to be. We got to keep our mind focused on that. Depending on the type of job you have, everybody don't have the same type of job. If you have a job where you're able to listen to music or listen to things while you're at work, of course, men, if you got to wear a hard hat or something like that while you're at work, you ain't going to be able to do it. And same thing with sisters. If you ain't able to have your head covering on, you might not be able to do it. But you're not going to be able to do it. But if you're able to have headphones on, you got various Bible apps, you got YouTube videos of the scriptures, you could just either play classes throughout the day, classes of things that you deal with, that you battle with. Find those classes, whether you got to download them, put them on your phone so you ain't using a whole lot of data, or use YouTube. And you play those classes throughout the day so you keep your mind focused on the commandments. Because when you go out into work, you see all type of wickedness. You see all type of evil. You go into the stores, they playing music. All this type of stuff is going on around us. So we got to find creative ways to keep our mind focused on the commandments. You have you a little note, a little small notebook that you carry. Like sisters, you can carry it around in your purse. Brothers, put it in your pocket. If you're a ranked man, you should have a precept book. You have these things. So, okay, when I take my 15-minute break, I'm finna go in my precept book. And I'm going to go through these precepts that I battle with so that I keep my mind focused on the commandments. Even while I'm out here at work and listening to all this filthy conversation while I'm at work, we have to work hard to stay focused, because everything in this world is set up against us. You driving on the expressway, you see wicked billboards about strip clubs and all of this foolishness. You see these wicked billboards talking about the Christianity, all type of stuff. White Jesus on the billboards, all of these things. Everything is set up for us to fall. So we have to do everything we can to keep focused when we're on our way to work. Let the word play. Let the scriptures play. You got various audio Bibles where you can listen to the scriptures. And a lot of times you listening to the scriptures, depending on your commute to work, you might make it through a whole book. Just let it keep on playing. You at work, okay, I'm listening to the book of Acts. You at work, okay, it went to Acts 1 all the way to 20, I think 6 or 28. You know what? Let me start it back over and listen to it again. And then you're gonna catch things as you're listening to it, and it's gonna build your spirit. It's gonna keep you in the faith. Read books, whatever books. You listen to the Bible throughout the day, even as you're working, so that you can keep your mind focused. If you're working on a job where you may interact with people, but you can listen to stuff. Have your Bluetooth in one ear and your other ear open. So you listening, somebody come and talk to you, you're still able to talk to them, but that the scriptures are still playing in your mind. The scriptures are still playing. You have to switch the task at that moment because you're talking to somebody. You got to switch your attention and be able to talk to them. So that way, you know what I'm saying, you're not like you're not appearing standoffish, or so to say, but you interacting with people. But you still keeping the word playing throughout the day. So let me move right along. I'm spending a little too much time on that. But it's necessary. So another definition of sincere. This is out the same book, the Expository Dictionary. It says guileless, pure, without guile, true, genuine, sincere. So we're looking at this with the singleness of mind, being focused. I'm going to go back to 1 Corinthians chapter 13, 2 Corinthians 13 and 5, excuse me. 2 Corinthians chapter 13 and verse 5. It says, examine yourselves, whether ye be in the faith. Prove your own selves. So this next point, so prove your own selves. So I'm going to read the definition of prove. So it says, demonstrate the truth or existence of something by evidence or argument. So when you examining yourself, you're proving your actions. Okay, do my actions line up with how the scriptures tell me to act? And if it don't, you got to fix it. You have to work to fix it. You got to do the necessary things to fix it. You got to search the scriptures, get counsel, and make the moves so that you can be moving according to the commandments. It says, some of those synonyms. It says, show beyond doubt, show to be true, prudence, submit. This goes right back to that definition of sincere. You got to be free from guile. You got to be, what did it say? Webster's 1828, sincere. It says, being in reality, what it appears to be, not feigned, not simulated. When you simulated it, when I read the word simulated, I think back when I was in high school, when I took driver's ed, we had it was like a little machine that you in it. It was like a video game where you playing with the car, but it was a simulation of you driving on the street, of you parallel parking. You're doing a three-point turn, things of that nature. And it was a simulation. So it wasn't real. So with us being sincere, we have to make sure that we're being real. We got to make sure that we're not living a simulated life. That we appearing one way before men, but behind closed doors, that's not who we truly are. We have to make sure that we change in our ways. We have to make sure we're making those changes. So I'm going to go back to Proverbs chapter 20. Chapter 4, I'm sorry. Proverbs chapter 4. We left off in verse 23. I'm going to start at verse 24. So Proverbs chapter 4 and verse 24. Wait, did I just read 23? Yeah, I did. 24. It says, put away from thee a froward mouth, and perverse lips put far from thee. So this, when we examine ourselves, we got to make sure we're putting away a froward mouth. What is a froward mouth? I'm going to read the definition of froward. So sometimes we have to look at up definitions, because English is a very confusing language. That's to say the least. So you got to look up these words so that you get a clear understanding of what the scriptures is telling you. So froward, it says habitually disposed to disobedience and opposition. So putting away from you a froward mouth is putting away from you the talk of the world, the talk of lying, the talk of being covetous. You always talking about what you can attain, how much money you can make, what type of car you gonna get next. That's what your mind is consumed with. Not saying that you're not gonna have these things, but that can't consume your conversation. You're always talking about foolishness. Your mind is not fixed on the commandments of God. That's a froward mouth. You have a wicked thought process, and that wicked thought process comes out through your words. It then says, and perverse lips put far from thee. So one of the definitions of perverse, it says, of a person or their actions showing a deliberate and obstinate desire to behave in a way that is unreasonable or unacceptable, often in spite of the consequences. So this is a person, it goes back to 2 Corinthians 13 and 5. Read it again. It says, examine yourselves, whether ye be in the faith. Prove your own selves. Know ye not your own selves? How that Jesus Christ is in you, except ye be reprobates. So what we just read in about the last part of the definition of perverse, often in spite of the consequences, that's talking about us having a reprobate mind. A reprobate mind is somebody that's void of judgment, meaning the things that you do, you don't care what the consequences are. You just going to do it. You're going to do you. You're going to be you. In all manner of wickedness, you're going to do you, and you don't care what the consequences are. That's a perverse mind. And when we examine ourselves, we have to put that thought process away. Just looked at the comment. I'm telling my age. I ain't that old, young man. Very young man. Where am I at? Verse 25, we're going to read on. I'm almost done. It says, let thine eyes look right on, and let thine eyelids look straight before thee, meaning we're focused. We're looking towards the kingdom. We're looking towards enduring. It says, ponder the path of thy feet, and let all thy ways be established. The only way our ways is going to be established is if we keep in the commandments. We have to be keeping the commandments for our ways to be established. And it says, turn not to the right hand nor to the left. Remove thy foot from evil. So as we are in this walk, we examining ourselves, we got to make sure that we are turning our ways towards the commandments of God. I got two more precepts and then we're going to close out. Sirach chapter 5 and verse 10. And I'm actually starting verse 9. It says, winnow not with every wind, and go not into every way, for so doth the sinner that hath a double tongue. That's what we just read with the definition of sincere. If you double-minded and going this way and that way and this way, you're not focused. You win in every doctrine. You're entertaining your previous self. Verse 10, it says, be steadfast in thy understanding, and let thy word be the same. So our actions have to match up in everything that we do. Whether we at work, whatever level of thing we at, we have to make sure our actions line up. One more scripture, Sirach chapter 11, verse 20. It says, be steadfast in thy covenant, and be conversant therein, and wax old in thy work. That goes right back to, we have to endure in keeping the commandments. That's why we are here. So I pray that you all were edified. I'm sorry I rushed through it. I started late, so I wanted to make sure I got through everything within the time frame that I have. So, hey, shalom, Most High in Christ, bless.
What is a nation? Nation is family. Nation is community. nation is men leading by example. Nation is women's support. Nation is children with role models. Nation is unity. Nation